Hi, I'm Catherine Turocy, and I'm here to give you the pre-concert lecture, Da Vinci and Dance. We're going to begin this with a PowerPoint, and as I'm getting to my PowerPoint, I would just like to give a big shout out to Kathy Fay and also Melinda Sullivan, thanking them for creating so many dance events at this year's festival. All right, I have another monitor next to me where I can see that everything is supposed to be showing is showing, and you'll see me every once in a while looking to my left, and that is why. Here we go. As we go through this lecture, I would like you to picture Da Vinci at the age he is in the self-portrait and imagine his passion for the performing arts. His ideas can be found in contemporary dance manuals of his time, such as this one on the left by Ibrio, as well as the one on the right by John Weaver, where Da Vinci is quoted, but the words are not attributed to Da Vinci. I wonder if perhaps by the 18th century, these concepts were already considered traditional and did not need to be referenced. The Renaissance and Baroque periods, and even as late as the French Revolution, explored the theory of cosmographia del minor mondo, the thought that God's universe, the macrocosm, is reflected in all things, the microcosm. The Vitruvian Man by Leonardo da Vinci demonstrates divine proportion and describes man's relationship to nature in terms of cosmic theory. Man is a microcosm of the macrocosm. In training my dancers, I like to use this image as a Rosetta Stone to explain period dance technique. At the time of Da Vinci, art and science followed measured mathematical principles related to harmony of the spheres. Hence, dance theory from the Renaissance to the Baroque and beyond shared the study of proportion and measure and the movement of the soul. Early Renaissance dancing masters referred to the cosmographia del minor mondo and discussed the movements of the soul. Dancing master Guglielmo Ebrio, in his dance treatise from 1463, said, "This virtue of the dance is none other than an external action reflecting interior spiritual movements or movements of the soul. These movements must agree with the measured and perfect consonances of a harmony that descends with delight through our hearing, to our intellect, and to our welcoming senses, where it then generates certain sweet emotions. These sweet emotions, just as if they are constrained against their nature, try as much as possible to escape and make themselves visible in active movement." This particular quote was translated by Jennifer Neville in her beautiful book called The Eloquent Body. As you can see, we're going to have a demonstration now. I'm going to stop the share and I'm going to ask you if you could possibly lay on the floor. If you're not ready to lay on the floor, we can do this from a standing or sitting position. It was Leonardo who did suggest laying on the floor in order to understand this concept of the Vitruvian Man. So let's go. And I have the floor right here. And he says that you should lay on the floor in an X, oh, like so, and imagine that there is a circle around your shape. In other words, we're here, and there's a circle that's going all the way around my body, like this, and my feet and my hands were touching the circumference of the circle. The circle, he says, represents the spiritual world. And the center of the circle is the navel. He says that man consists of the marriage between the spiritual world, which is represented by the circle, and the material world, which is represented by the square. So in the square, just go ahead and bring your feet together, bring your arms down, and you should be able to feel the square. The top of the head is touching one line of the square. The arms, the side lines, and the feet, the bottom leg. And at this point, if you take a vertical axis and a horizontal axis, In the square, you'll discover that the center of the material world would be the genitals, which makes sense, since this is how we experience our desire to recreate the material world. He also talks about some other aspects which are not so obvious in the Vitruvian Man, but if you read the Latin underneath the image, you will discover this, which is Leonardo says that because we are a microcosm of the macrocosm, we could think of our flesh. So go ahead and just squeeze your muscles, squeeze your flesh. We could think of our flesh as being like the earth. And we can think of the bones that we feel underneath if we're squeezing. The bones are akin to the rocks. So the earth consists of rocks, and on top of the rocks are lies the earth, the dirt. So that would be our flesh. He then talks about the sea, and he talks about the motion of the sea as it ebbs and flows. He talks about the tides, and he asks us to think of a river that's coming out of the sea or out of the ocean, so that the water flows up the river, all the way up through the wooded areas, whatever, wherever it's going. And then when the tide changes, it flows out from underneath us. So I'd like you just to imagine, bend your knees, imagine that you're by the sea and you're feeling the water come through the toes, it's coming up through your body, up through the legs, excuse me, up through the torso, then all the way out through the head. So this is one of the images I give to my dancers to feel that embodiment of their body being the microcosm of the macrocosm. I also do ask them to stand in the X, like the spiritual world. And here you feel that your limbs are shooting out from the core of the body like spokes of a wheel. And just try this just to see what it feels like. And there is that equilateral triangle between the two feet. And then I ask them to go ahead and inhabit the material world. And as they go to the square, right away they can feel the pull of gravity on their arms. So we develop these ideas as we're taking this practice into our Baroque dance technique. But I think that's probably enough of a sharing right now. Let me see if I can get back to my screen and continue to share our slideshow. Okay, so I'm just looking. Oh, yes, there it is. Okay, so let's go on to the next one. All right, here we go. Just try pressing once more. And I'll just try pressing one more time and see if there's any other talking of the screen to me. Ah, it did change. Okay, that was good. And let's just make sure that was the right one. Okay, we're in the game. The dancer moves with the movement of the soul and follows geometrical paths in space, such as the one above found in Cesare Negri's manual, Nobilita di Dama, printed in 1600. Compare this design with the orbit chart of Venus on the right, drawn by Cassini, who lived between 1625 and 1712. The intertwining circles and serpentine lines are common to both images. These designs are not random. They reflect studies of motion in the planets and stars ruled by a divine force. It was believed that by imitating the motion of the celestial sky, art could form a channel between the earth and the heavens, allowing the blessings to flow to earth. The image on the right illustrates how the orbit charts were formed. This illustration is from a blog which contains a wealth of math and science animations from Matthew Henderson. The beautiful animation is based on the data from the University of Wisconsin geoscientist Stephen Dutch, who created an interactive graphic in 2012, demonstrating how Venus's closest orbital points to Earth over 8 years map out the points of a remarkable but not perfect pentagram in the sky, because actually the orbits tend to be more of an elliptical shape, but the one for Venus is closer to circular. The orbits are approximated as circles, so this animation cannot be used for accurate predictions, according to Dutch. Now, as you're looking at this, if you see that earth-colored circle here, that would be Earth. And if you look at the blue-colored circle there, that would be Venus. So as both planets orbit the sun, the direct line of sight from one planet to the other changes angles. And these are what are recorded in the animation, but also in the chart by Cassini. Garden designs were drawn from an aerial view in the Renaissance and Baroque, and also reflected mathematical celestial movements. Geometrical shapes and repeating ratios related to nature and life itself. They inspired the gardens of Versailles, designed by André Lenôtre. One can even see a reference to the Fibonacci sequence of the rose, revealing how the petals emerge from the rose bloom in a spiral pattern following the Fibonacci series. And here you can just look at this. This is the square, and here we're looking at the square pattern. And inside of that is the diamond. There's the diamond. And I'm sorry, it switched. And then you also see another square, but here the square points are just pinpointed by these rounds. And if you look over here, we're getting further into the diagrams for the sequence of the rose. However, in this pattern, you don't see it so much because the roses are probably blooming in the garden. Here, a late 18th century dance plan on the left and the Tuileries garden plan on the right share the same play with geometrical shapes, referring to divine proportions and orbits. The landscape of the garden and the dance take on a third dimension in their performance. And by this, I mean that the notation of dance is just in two dimensions, and it's taken into the third dimension with the body of the dancer. Just as the plan for the garden is taken into a third dimension with the actual plantings, and then it's performed or experienced with people walking through the garden. Music also has a landscape and design in its plan, which comes alive in the third dimension when played on instruments. All three arts are intended to bring the audience into a shared aesthetic inspired by the cosmos. Here we have a short excerpt from La Royale, the Sarabande, choreographed by Guillaume-Louis Pécour and published in 1713 in Paris. Dancers Caroline Copeland, who is very much associated with the festival and is the associate director of our company, and Alcee Jesse, also in our company and with the festival, are dancing in this video lecture, Parquet to Parterre, which was created by me in collaboration with Barnard College and Columbia University. So I think I just have to press, hopefully, right here. Here's the dance notation for the dance, and it reflects the pathways, or you might say the negative space in the design, whoops, in the design for the garden. All right, going on, Da Vinci's art clearly explores the divine proportion, also known as the golden ratio, which was deemed to be beautiful because it is found in the very building blocks of the human body. If you take a look at the arm diagram over here, and you take the measurement, or you look at the smaller unit called A, and you compare that measurement to B, It's revealed that B is 1.16 eighths larger than A. Now, this golden ratio, it's an irrational number, so it's not perfect, it's not rational, and it kind of wavers a little bit. So it's approximately that. If one adds the measurement of A plus B, this can be seen as one unit. One unit which is larger, which is 1.618 larger than the next unit, C. Hence, the limbs and body of man repeat this 1.618 ratio as the body builds on itself. It is the building block ratio of growth, which can also be discovered in many plants and animals. And this ratio is also used quite a bit, not only in painting, such as in this painting by Leonardo da Vinci, but also in building, in constructing architecture. It's not the only ratio, obviously, but in order to make the buildings reflect the sense of man and his proportions, this is the ratio that's more often used. Looking past da Vinci's time on Earth, we see dancing masters in the 18th century, such as Louis de Pelche in his Leçon de Danse from 1772, continue to use body proportions to rule the dance, just as the Renaissance dancing masters did. He illustrates the first movement of the demi-coupé with the dancer on a measured floor. So that's, you see the little almost graph-like representation on the floor. Each moving step must be no larger than the length of one's foot. In sliding the foot to the side position and then setting down the heel, the measurement is the length of one's own foot. So you're taking foot to the side, and if you put the heel down, you'll see that that would be the measurement of his foot. And actually, in this particular case, each square is measured to be the proportions of his foot. So perfection is proportional movement determined by the proportion of one's own body. Courtly dance, or pure dance, also called la belle danse, is based on a geometrical balance of the body in motion. And this motion is in turn affected by the path of the dance in space, which in itself reflects a metaphorical idea related to the mathematics of universal motion. In these two images, the golden spiral is a metaphor for taking hands, where two become one. This refers to the three elements of classical art: beauty, memory, and unity. Notice how the notation here is adjusted. Okay, I can find my cursor. Yes, is adjusted to reflect the shape of the golden spiral. Linking this dance with the other arts. So the notations, the people who were engraving the notation were playing with this idea of reflecting harmony of the sphere, geometrical principles in their art. And here we have the two dancers, they're giving the right hand, and they're going to be taking this spiral as they perform the figure with the right hand. In Renaissance and Baroque dance, measure was reflected in the proportion of one's body, which determined the size of the movement. The dance step measured the floor pattern or cosmic metaphor of the dance. The pattern is the metaphor. The dance measure was in harmony with the meter and measure and cadence of the music. Music and dance reflected meters in poetry, which becomes obvious when reconstructing a dance choreographed to a sung air, such as the pavane, Belle qui tienne ma vie, or the lure, L'immeuble vainqueur. Measure was part of the shared aesthetic underlying all art and related the arts to the concept of unity, also referred to as oneness. I wanted to include these main figures of the minuet by Gottfried Taubert. He did not have pictures of them in his book, so I was forced to draw these pictures. Anyway, I just wanted to talk about unity and the memory of unity. Here he has the infinity sign. So he first starts out saying a main figure of the minuet is the infinity sign or the figure eight. There we are. Then he goes to the half figure eight or the reversed S or the lunar orbit. And he's the only one I found who calls this the lunar orbit. So if you look at this lunar orbit, you realize that it is half of the infinity sign. So in performing this, you're performing this with the memory that the whole is infinity, but right now you're only in half infinity. If you look at these shapes, you see the circular nature of the shapes, and the circular nature of the shapes refers to the spiritual world, as we said before. Then Taubert, and this is different from the other French and English dancing masters, in his manual, he talks about another figure called the Arabic number two. And if you look at it, it combines the circular part of the spiritual world, and then it gets into the straight lines of the material world or the square. And then we go all the way to the material world with the Z. So just the nature of the Z fits very nicely into a square. And because of its angularness, it does refer to the material world. So here we have that really a sort of summary of figures specific to the minuet. In addition to these figures, which he calls the main figures, you have the collateral figures, which are the giving of the right hand, the giving of the left hand, and the giving of both hands. As da Vinci illustrates with the Vitruvian Man, the part of the whole contains a resonance of the complete work. Beauty is the proportion which refers to the memory of the whole. Beauty, memory, unity. In both Renaissance and Baroque dance, we also see the importance of the circle. For instance, the circles I just mentioned in the minuet. Right, especially at the end of the dance in the minuet, where dancers take both hands. Circle and then retreat. The circle is the expression of unity and the spiritual world. The unending line of the circle, according to cosmic theory, has been called forevering by architect Steve Bass in his book and lectures on classical architecture. Forevering is the act of a person joining the cosmic aesthetic as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. It is the experience of what dancing master Gottfried Taubert refers to as the infinitesimal. Taubert makes many references to math in his 1717 treatise, which is translated as The Complete Dancing Master. And this is simply one example of his references to math. Well, it's time to push yourself away from the computer, stand up, and embody da Vinci's Vitruvian Man as we dance a pavane phrase in preparation to receive the cosmic connection with the music of Dulce Memoir and Leonardo da Vinci's The Hidden Music. Perhaps while listening to the concert, you will also feel the hidden dance. All right, so let's just step away. I'm going to do stop share. And while you're getting yourselves together and thinking about things, I would just like to thank my husband, James Richmond, who not only is a harpsichordist, but he also has a degree in the history of science. And he was the one who was challenging me a little bit on infinity and on the idea of infinitesimal numbers. But then he did mention that it was Wallace in England who invented the infinity sign in the 1650s, and then it was Leibniz in Germany who was having that argument and establishing that idea of infinitesimal numbers in the 1670s. And remind yourself that the dancing masters during the 18th century were educated. Many of them went to college. And in fact, it was Taubert who was a philosopher, teacher, a philosopher in the university in Leipzig, and his specialty was dance. Okay, I suppose I can. Oh, I did stop sharing that. Great. So let's just look at the pavane. I'm just going to go out here. And we were talking about measure, And we were talking about your steps as not being longer than the measurement of your feet. So let me just start here. We'll review what the Pavan phrase is in a moment. But my shoe size is about 10 inches. So let's say I'm standing on my right foot, and then my first step is going to be taken with my left foot, which would be about 10 inches from that other foot. Okay, so that's my first single. Then my next single is on with my right foot, would be about 10 inches here, and then that would be my two singles. And now I'm ready to do the double. So I have to have three shoes for that. That would be 10 inches, 10 inches, and another 10 inches. Okay. There we go. So the Pavan consists of a single followed by another single, and followed by a double, which would be three steps, one, two, three. Okay, so the idea is a double, and a single. So you have two one steps, bump, bump, and then you have three steps. So you could think of it as like two against three. And if you think about three over two, and you think about ratios and Fibonacci, you'll find that this is at the beginning of the Fibonacci series, which helps to investigate the idea of the divine proportion. Now, whether or not the dancing masters were thinking of this, I think especially in the beginning in the Renaissance, that they were trying to make this coordination or this comparison or this sharing of mathematical ideas from the dance to the music to the geometry. So if we have 10 inches here, that's my first step is 10 inches, and then another and close, and then another 10 inches, that would be 20 inches. And then I perform my next two measures, which would be the double, that would be 10, whoops, 10, 20, and then another 10, and another 10, and another 10, so that would be three tens, so that would be 30. So again, we have like that idea of 20 and 30. Now, if you're going to dance this, you might think about this as you're dancing this. So rather than play a pavane, I'd just like you to think about your favorite pavane. And if you don't have a favorite pavane, let's jump to the 21st century and think about the tune, which is usually played as a processional march in June, which is this month. And the march that is basically called Here Comes the Bride. Ya-dum-da-da, ya-dum-da-da, ya-dum-ba-ba-dum-ba-dee-dum-ba-ba. So it's perfect if you're thinking about all this harmony of the spheres. What does it feel like? Ya-dum-ba-da, ya-dum-ba-da, ya-dum-da-dee-dum-da-da-dum-da-da. Okay, well, I think I'm not going to pass my audition for BAMF for being a singer, but hopefully you have gained something from this exploration into ideas of proportion of Da Vinci's Vitruvian Man and how it relates to the dance and to the music. So I'll just leave you with that thought. Thank you very much. I appreciate being able to present these ideas. And I'm looking forward to the concert. See you at the concert. Bye.